Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.
Thanks for coming on. I hope your weather out there is better than ours. We're having a thunderstorm right now.
it's delightful. It was almost 100 yesterday, and now it's 70.
Oh, that's nice. That's much better. Well, let's start out. Tell us a little bit about the National Association of Pro-Life Nurses. Love to hear how they got started, what they do, where they're located, all of that.
Well, I may be one of the first members or somewhere that came in. I think they were there before, but I was head of Missouri Nurses for Life. And then I got the call. They said, you've got to join. I said, okay, I'll do that too. And it's wonderful. They started, I think, back in the 70s, and I've worked under a couple different directors, but I've been with them, oh my goodness, since the 90s. You know, it's amazing how it works. And it's a wonderful organization. I encourage everybody, go to our Facebook page. It's our address, you know, our is www.nursesforlife.org.
Okay, that's good, because I didn't bring any information along, so that's good.
Oh, yeah. We know that one. I'm also an advisor for the HALO group, too, which is the Healthcare Advocacy and Leadership Organization, which is another one that has a helpline. I want to go ahead and do it so in case we get busy.
Sure, go ahead.
And that is www.halovoice.org. And on their site, they have a helpline, which is very interesting. It's the only one I know of in the United States, but it is where people can call when they're running into problems, especially at the end of life. They don't feel someone's getting enough, and it's got a lot of good information. I've written part of it that helps to educate people about things like ventilators. And I mean, I've been a nurse for over 50 years and mostly in critical care, but I've worked oncology, dialysis, just about every kind of nursing, including home hospice and home health. It was a very interesting, I've had a very interesting time.
Oh, it sounded.
I was actually told by Wesley Smith, he said, I can get you a big book advance for your autobiography. And I said, no, thank you. I write enough. but it has been very, very interesting. But that's another great group. And that helpline number is so helpful. And the information on it, very few people know about it, but they have a lot. Mm-hmm. In Nurses for Life that we do. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful organization, and we have people, in fact, our board of directors, we're in many different states. Mm-hmm. We do have a phone number, and we're supposedly based in Washington, D.C. That's where we have like an office, but it kind of goes to, the phone calls go to us, you know, afterwards. Okay. But it's someplace people can write, you know, and get things. But what we try to do is we cover every issue from conception till death. And we work very hard. We let people know, especially our nurses. Oh, we give out a $1,000 scholarship every year to a nurse who has been active, a student nurse who's been active in the pro-life movement, who has a letter of recommendation and writes an essay. Oh. And so we are promoting pro-life nursing from the beginning. Mm-hmm. And it's so important because I'm old enough. I remember in 1973 with the Roe versus Wade decision came down. And I was really surprised later to find out some of the medical schools were talking about weeding out these pro-life people, you know, anti-choice is what they call us.
Wow.
And we're starting to see that kind of come back again because it's a very different world than it was. And when it happened in 1973, I was working in what is now a level one trauma unit. I loved it. And we all worked together. It was beautiful. We met for pizza afterwards. The doctors and nurses were very close. But when Roe versus Wade came in, I remember we were working on a patient that was comatose supposedly. And they were talking about Roe versus Wade. And they said, well, where do you stand? And I said, well, of course, I'm against abortion. I said, we always have been. The AMA, the Medical Nurse, the American Medical Association, everybody's been against it. And they said, what if you were raped? What is this? And I was attacked. And that was the first time I knew I was totally politically incorrect. Didn't change my mind. But I thought, oh my gosh, why are they so vehement? You know, I'm not sitting yelling at them, calling them murderers or baby killers. I was just saying, you know, how can we do that? And but that was their big thing. What if you were raped? I said, I'd have a baby. No, you wouldn't. Oh, yes, I would. So anyway, it went on like that. But I knew that it was kind of different. In fact, my husband now, since I'm so outspoken, he said, you know, if you go into the gulag, I'm not going to be visiting you.
Oh, jeez.
Just bring me some coffee.
Oh, my.
My kids won't let me put the grandchildren's pictures on Facebook because they said I'm too controversial and they're afraid somebody will try to get through me with my grandchildren.
Wow.
I don't know. I do it, but yeah. Oh, they are so adorable. Anyone who sends me a private message, I'll show you how adorable it is. But when Nurses for Life got started, it was just wonderful. And Jody Breakiron used to be a nurse, and I was pulled into it.
Can I just interrupt you a second? Did the organization start because of Roe v. Wade, do you think?
Yes. Yes. That was the catalyst. And people said, we've got to do something. And, you know, I didn't know about it, but I was kind of forced to be head of Missouri Nurses for Life because I'd been with the Archdiocese. I traveled all over the country. I worked under now Archbishop Joseph Nauman, who's head of the Pro Life Committee for the United States Catholic Bishops. Mm-hmm. And that was a wonderful thing. And I was so shy. And he goes, yeah, we're going to have you talk. I go, what? And he was just wonderful to me. And I said, but I've got a baby daughter. I'm a single parent. You know, I wasn't a single parent. I said, I've got a baby daughter and you want meetings? And they go, bring her. We'll have toys. So I went down to the chancery office with my two-year-old and they had toys and it was just wonderful. And so it was so good. And Father Nauman, we always call him Father Joe, was absolutely wonderful. And our pro-life committee just became great. Mm-hmm. But I kind of did that for 2 years, mm-hmm. and then I moved on to other things. But one of the things that got me into some other areas, I was always pro-life, and I had my children, so I was a stay-at-home mom, and I thought, I want to get involved, but I can't because I've got these kids. So I was reading up on it, about how am I going to do this? And sometimes things happen, and I wound up doing some picketing outside the abortion clinics. Mm-hmm. One time I took my two-year-old along with me, and I always wanted to make sure we had a sign that said, please, we can help you with a telephone number. That's so important. That's how we can save those babies.
Nancy, excuse me, just when you talk about telephone numbers, we do have it up on the screen, but sometimes people are just listening. If you want to call in and ask Nancy a question, it would be 610-378-0426. That's 378-0426. Just so you know that you're welcome to call in. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Nancy, we can take the calls here and then we can tell you what if anyone asks. So
That's great.
Yeah.
But that got me started in the pro-life movement, but what really did it, I did do some, they had a boundary, you know, where we could go and pick it, you know, with signs and everything. And one day my two-year-old jumped out of her stroller and went onto the grass at the Planned Parenthood place. And I thought, oh my God, they're going to take us away. And I brought her back. She thinks now she's got two children of her own. She thinks that's hilarious. But what really got me, I was with these kids and I thought, well, I want to do more, but how can I? I had three children. And then I had my daughter, Karen, and she was the one who changed my life. I had a beautiful little boy and a beautiful little girl. And my husband actually was a doctor. He was a psychiatrist. And we had our third baby and something was wrong in the room. I looked at her, I said, she looks great. She's not crying. Why aren't you telling me something? What's going on? nobody would talk to me until I went in the recovery room and a doctor came in and said, your child has Down syndrome. It was 1982. And ironically, my husband and I were one of the couples who wanted to adopt baby Joe, which was then a big case. Mm-hmm. A little boy was born with Down syndrome and a very easily correctable problem in his throat so he could eat and live. But the parents said no, and a judge upheld them. And they said, well, the doctor said he'd just be a blob. And we were shocked, but all the media stories were saying, oh, these wonderful parents and everything. My husband goes, let's adopt. And I said, well, I'm pregnant with my third child. I said, well, I guess if that'll save the baby's life, I'm up for it. Mm-hmm. Well, what happened is the parents refused everybody because they didn't want their other children to know that they had a brother out there with Down syndrome. I was just, when he died, he starved to death. And the doctors,
doctors
were interesting. One of my friends was Dr. Ann Bannon, the late Dr. Ann Bannon, who was president. She started the National Doctors for Life. She investigated, wrote a great article for the Human Life Review. I took care of Ann until her death. She was a great lady. But she looked into it and she said the doctors were upset. And that's why they said, let's appeal this. Because that was one of the things that they used in nursing school to teach us ethics. They said, what if a baby's born with Down syndrome and needs an operation? And of course, the answer was, you operate. What if the parents are against it? You go to court, you have to operate on the baby. Mm-hmm. And so this is why it just kind of blew my mind. It blew both of our minds. And what happened with the baby, the doctors, the pediatricians were so upset, they tried to appeal it. And it was terrible. The media was totally against this. They thought that was just fine with this baby. What it meant is he couldn't eat or drink until he had this problem and his throat fixed. Mm. And what happened while lawyers were in the air flying to the US Supreme Court to appeal the case, the little boy died of starvation and dehydration.
Oh my gosh.
I was just crestfallen. I thought, oh my God. And then a couple months later, I had my baby, my little girl named Karen, who also had Down syndrome. And she also had a heart defect. I would have killed to have that defect that baby Joe had. Mm-hmm. She had a very serious heart defect. In fact, so serious that when I was in the recovery room, the doctor came in and said, well, your baby has Down syndrome. And the first thing I asked was about the heart, because I knew I'd taken care of children with Downs. And they said, well, you can take her home, but she'll die in 2 weeks to 2 months.
Oh,
well, that's something. I've got these two little kids at home dying to see their new, you know, sibling. And I was just shocked. And nobody was there for me. My husband had gone home to take care of the kids. And I was just flabbergasted. And they gave me the baby finally in the room. And what they do with the mothers too is I was put in a room by myself. I thought, oh, this is what happens. We used to put the terminally ill people in a room by themselves. Mm-hmm. You feel rejected. You know, I've done a lot since then to help change that kind of stuff. And it was really terrible. But a cardiologist came in and explained what happened. And he says, well, he said, she'll probably die. But if she does, there is an operation. But I'll see you in 3 weeks. So I went to see him in 3 weeks. And he goes, wow, she looks pretty good. I said, well, I thought so. You know, we're doing everything we can. And he looked at her and he said, you know what? She's got an 80 to 90% chance of survival with one open heart surgery. Mm. And I was elated. And then he goes, but I'll support you either way.
I said, either way.
Either way. Oh, gee.
I said, excuse me. What did you just say? He said, well, if you don't want to do it, I understand. I said, listen, bud. My husband was a little perturbed. I said, I'm sorry, but if you want to medically discriminate against my daughter, and that's what is medical discrimination, you can't touch her. And he goes, oh, he wound up changing and he became the Down Syndrome Association favorite cardiac surgeon.
Oh, neat.
That's what I mean. When you speak out for pro-life, you never know, but this guy totally changed. Oh. Well, what year was that? That was 1982. Karen was born in September of 1982. And we tried to keep her going. And I would go into my pediatrician and she wasn't gaining weight. We were trying everything we could. And I said, how about a feeding tube? You know, anything. She had to be 10 pounds or 6 months old before they could operate. So I was desperate, you know. And my pediatrician, who was a woman, said, no, don't worry about it. And we kept working with her. And finally, she really got sick. And she had to go into the hospital with pneumonia. And I found out that the pediatrician had made her a do not resuscitate.
Oh.
Because she felt I was, quote, too emotionally involved with that retarded baby, unquote.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I was mad. I was really mad.
They can
mad.
Do that without your permission?
Well,
evidently, they did that without your permission.
Oh, it changed. I found out, oh, I raised hell. Interestingly, it is still being done today. In fact, I just gave testimony to this gal in Ohio, and we worked on the Simon's Law in Missouri, where a baby with trisomy 18, it's not Down syndrome, it's another one, where her baby was made a do not resuscitate and was given non-nutrition comfort feeds to keep him quiet. He needed an open heart surgery. The parents were holding on to him. The heart surgeon was supposed to come in the next day and he started to go south. And they called the nurses. They said, please call somebody, call somebody. And they didn't. And the baby died in their arms.
Oh.
Cheryl Crozier, God bless her. She's a wonderful person. She was just horrified by the whole thing. And when I found out about it, I knew, because I had been doing research on this stuff. There's something called medical futility, which hurts everybody of all age groups. And not surprisingly, we found out that the Catholic hospital where this occurred had a medical futility policy that would go over the parents' objections. They didn't even know.
Wow.
So they could have taken him to court and sued, and maybe people would have paid more attention, but instead Cheryl went and said, we need a law for Simon. It's called Simon's Law. So we worked on it, and it took 5 years to get it through. We had a head of a committee who said, oh, you know, doctors would never do something like that. And they go, Nancy, would you testify? I said, oh, hell yes. It took 5 years. Finally, they let it out of committee, and it was passed unanimously, practically. And we got the first Simon's Law. Now they're trying it in Ohio and other places. So I sent my testimony to Ohio since I couldn't get there. And we're fighting that. But this is what I mean is everybody goes, you know, and this was what got me.
Well, I just want to interrupt you here just to let you know, here in Pennsylvania, we have a Down syndrome bill that's been in the works for several years now. And the good news is it recently passed in the House. And it just came out of committee in the health committee in the Senate. So that's going to be up for a
abortion?
Vote.
Pardon Was that me? For abortion? Was
for
that for abortion? For
protection, yes. Protect any baby that's a Down syndrome in baby in utero will be protected from abortion.
Some courts overruling
now,
that. I think it's a wonderful
thing. This bill has been in the works for a while, but every year the support grows. And just as you're saying, I mean, what has it been, 30 years now, 40 years? That
close to 40 years.
Yeah, that you've been involved in this bill. This issue is a long time coming. Sad to say, we're told our governor is going to veto the bill, but that is not going to stop this movement and stop this effort. And, you know, if it doesn't get passed in his term, then so be it. We'll hopefully have a governor in the next election that will be pro-life and will sign this bill, because to discriminate against these babies just because of a diagnosis of, you know, it's,
well, you know,
as you know, it's ludicrous.
Well, you probably remember too, one thing that kept me out of the pro-life movement originally was the pro-life people were saying, if this goes through, we will next see infanticide and euthanasia. And I didn't believe them. I couldn't see how that could possibly happen. So my daughter and baby Doe got me four square in the pro-life movement.
Yeah.
And I, you know, forever. And it's really interesting. So now I've given testimony. I travel around. I also travel around speaking against assisted suicide bills.
I want to mention your name again because we don't have it up on the screen. We're speaking with Nancy Valko. She's from St. Louis, Missouri. She's a spokesperson for the National Association of Pro-Life Nurses, but she also does a lot of speaking on end-of-life issues. So we want to just welcome you again in case someone's tuned in and didn't hear the introduction. So go ahead. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Oh, no, that's fine. I feel like Doubting Thomas, you know, and I think God showed me for sure this is what happened. By the way, National Association of Pro-Life Nurses is not denominational. We take people of any religion or no religion. It's not
a
religious organization, which is important for people to know. But that really got me interested. Yeah. And I started getting into other things, including living wills. And there was a bill for a living will up in Missouri. And I said, it's not going to work. And I told the Archdiocese, and I said, you've got a problem with this. There are starving people to death, brain injured people in the East, Paul Brophy and other cases, which apparently no one heard about. There were only a few of us that knew, where they're taking feeding tubes out of people who were seriously brain injured. They call them vegetative, which I hate the term. And interestingly, in 71, I was working in this trauma unit, and this really got to me too, is I was there when a young boy was brought in totally crunched in a car accident, and the surgeon said, well, you know, he's gonna die before morning, and if he didn't, he'd be a vegetable. And I was shocked he said that. I always treated my patients like they could hear. And they laughed at me, everybody laughed. They said, do you talk to your refrigerator? I go, sure, why not? Doesn't hurt anything. And I started working with this young man. He didn't die. And I started working with him. And then one day I said, I call him Mike. I wrote it up for the First Things. Richard John Newhouse wanted me to write articles, so I mentioned it in there. I said, come on, Mike, move a finger, move a finger. He finally moved a finger on command.
Wow.
We called the neurosurgeon in. I said, Mike, move your finger. He did. He goes, he wouldn't do it for the surgeon. And he goes, you know. So finally, we got him off the ventilator, which they never thought he'd do. And I got him to say hi on command. So I said, get the neurosurgeon back in. So they brought him back in. And he said, hi. And the neurosurgeon about passed out. And he says, but ladies, I don't think you've really done him any favors. You know, it was awful. So what they did is they sent him to a nursing home 60 miles away. And I thought, no one's gonna work with him. But the other nurses became convinced. We were talking to everybody then. And we started having people wake up. But 18 months later, I was still working in the same unit. This handsome young man walks into our unit. He says, remember me? We go, no. He said, I'm Mike.
Really?
We just drove here 60 miles.
Oh,
I'm getting
gosh.
Married. I wanted to thank you for saving my life. And people were crying. I mean, it was incredible. And I said, oh, Mike, you're not gonna remember this. But she used to move for me and even said something, but you wouldn't do it for the neurosurgeon. He goes, oh yeah. The reason I didn't, I was mad at him. I heard him call me a vegetable. True story.
Really? So
they drew your unconsciously. Yeah.
How about that?
And so I've been working with brain injured people to the point where I was bringing so many people back, they asked if I was a witch.
Oh my gosh.
So that was another thing I was working. I said, no, actually, I'm Catholic. But I started working on that and started writing about it and doing that kind of stuff. And I had somebody from the UK call, and I knew this woman, Jane Hoyt, up in Minnesota, and she wrote a gentle approach to helping people wake up, you know. And I had people with strokes, all sorts of stuff. And I used her pamphlet, and I went out and talked all over. And then I even had a man from the UK call, and he goes, oh, my wife, it's terrible. She never will wake up, you know. Do you have anything? And I said, well, I have this pamphlet. Let me give you all the information. Please keep in touch and let me know what happens. So I didn't hear from him. 6 months later, he calls me. I said, wow. I said, how's your wife? He says, I'm really mad. I said, what? She won't stop talking.
Oh, my gosh.
Irony of ironies.
Good. That's
I know.
Good.
So that's what I mean. You get into pro-life, you have things happen.
Yeah.
Then, unfortunately, my daughter did die when she was 5.5 months old. And that was really tough. She was in a children's hospital.
Did she ever have an operation? Did you ever have the operation?
They could get it. She was 5.5 months.
Because she didn't gain the weight?
What happened was she didn't gain the weight. Then she got a pneumonia. Mm. And she was put into another hospital. And we got her down to children's. And here in St. Louis, we have marvelous hospitals. And I talked to the head of cardiovascular, the guy who was in charge of anything, Arnie Strauss, wonderful man. And he says, you know, what do you want to do? And I said, you know, we've had enough of this. I want this child to get every chance. So she was on a ventilator, not doing well. And some resident came in and he goes, why don't we just pull the plug and get this over with? And I refused to make her a DNR. I said, I will know when she needs a DNR. I have no problem with it when it's futile. You know, there's nothing wrong with it, but this is wrong. And I went to the head of cardiology. I went to Arnie and I said, Arnie, this is what happened, what this guy did. And I told him, if you touch any of my daughter's tubes, I'm going to sue yourself. So he says, well, I'll fire the little whatever. And I said, well, try to educate him first before you fire him. You know, maybe he's educable, because he was ready to fire the guy. And it changed. And what was so interesting, despite everything, we did lose Karen. Arnie went on to open the first Down syndrome clinic that in our city that took care of children at any stage and took care of their special needs. Sometimes there's hearing problems or cardiac problems. And it was wonderful. Then I wrote a pamphlet on prenatal testing because people said, why did you get pregnant again? And why didn't you have prenatal testing? I said, because I'm educated. And I wrote a pamphlet on it. And I had my last daughter, and my husband unfortunately had a complete breakdown, the doctor, and he was hospitalized, shock treatments. It was really bad. And I went in and visited him on the psych ward, and the doctor was there. And he says, you know, this is not a good time for you to be pregnant. I said, well, at least I know something good is going to happen in November. You're not too sure if he'll ever be, you know, able to work again. And he goes, maybe your husband would get better if you weren't pregnant.
Oh my goodness.
I was so mad. I wanted to hit him.
Oh my word, but I couldn't.
So what I did at that moment, I said, I didn't know if it was a boy or girl. I said, if it's a girl, her name will be Joy. In your face, Joy. And I don't care what happens, what she's like.
Yeah.
So Joy is now 36 years old and has babies of her own. But that is how bad, and I'm going, I'm a nurse. I went through there. What, how did the medical and nursing professions get so stupid?
And you're just one nurse. That has had so many experiences. It just shows the power of one person. Imagine if you hadn't spoken up on all these issues that you've talked about already. I'm sure there's even more. But it just shows you how valuable, invaluable, are the pro-life nurses in our country. And God bless you for your willingness to take a stand, because I'm kind of the same, probably be the same way. But
you have to speak out. People are afraid to speak out.
They are. Most people are, sad to say.
Oh, and I was too, you know. What really was funny, though, and this is another story, why you should always speak up. My husband got sick and took everything, left the family. I had three little kids, no money. He skipped the state to get out of child support. It was just a big old mess. He's passed away now. But it was hard, and I had to go get a job. They were not hiring nurses. They were laying them off. And my mother had come down with Alzheimer's and thyroid cancer and had a trach. And my dad goes, I can't take care of her. So I took care of her. And she was close to death. So I thought, well, I'll hold off having to get a job. I didn't know how. I'm very frugal. So she passed away. I took care of her till she died. And then I went out looking and they were laying off nurses, which I had no idea that would happen. Mm-hmm. I went out. Nobody had talked to me because I had this gap in my resume when I was a stay-at-home mom for 8 years. And I felt bad. Nobody would even interview me. And somebody said, you didn't spend those 8 years eating bonbons. Tell them what you did. I said, I didn't get paid for any of it. I started a program in hospitals to help new parents with children who have disabilities because they didn't know. I'd been on both sides of that bedpan. I said, let me help. We went to the medical students. I started taking care of kids with different problems. I would take care, I would help women out who had kids on ventilators. I went to the state legislature and said, hey, these people need help. They need money. All sorts of stuff I gotten into. So I started putting it down. And I said, it sounds kind of impressive, but I didn't make any money. Nobody asked how much I made. So I went to the very last hospital I could do with my three kids. They were 10, 8, and 2. And I went to the last hospital and I go, here's my resume. And they looked at it and they go, we only have part-time. Where would you like to work? And I almost burst into tears. I was so grateful. And I went into oncology. It said, you want to go back to ICU? I said, no, because it was $400 to take a course to be updated. So I said, I'd like to work oncology because I took care of my mom until she died. And I did, and it was a wonderful place. Then different things happened, and I had a daughter who was wonderful, Marie, who was the greatest kid, and she, my kids were in public school, or as I call it, pagan school, after going through a Catholic school, and she got into drugs, and that was a 16-year battle to find out, and I found out what happened originally, because mothers have things. She went to a party and came back, and something was wrong. You just knew. And I said, what happened? I said, did anyone get fresh with you? No, no, Mom. Finally, I said, I looked at her. I said, were you raped? She goes, no. She was.
Oh, my goodness. She was
being raped. That started her off. Off and on. We got her help. She got better. She actually wound up going to community college and then got a degree from Washington University in mechanical engineering.
Oh, wow.
I mean, God kind of helped me. Mm-hmm. Things happened so I could get things done. With a mechanical degree, mechanical engineering degree, we thought the worst was over. And she got married. Uh-huh. And then she divorced her husband and she went back into it again. Just the sweetest person. She was named after the Blessed Mother. I wrote a whole piece on that for the Women for Faith and Family magazine. And then one day, you know, she was seemed to be doing a little better. She was living with her sister, and I got a phone call on October 10th, and 12 years ago, and said, this is the police. Are you Marie's mother? And I knew what had happened. Because I had talked to her. I always talked to her. She had read Derek Humphrey's book, Final Exit. He's the one who believes that getting assisted in suicide is a fundamental right. I told her, I said, you can't do that. Stay off that. There are suicide websites out there. She read it. She goes, yeah, Mom. When she died, we thought it was an overdose. Mm-hmm. It wasn't. Because one of the detectives said, I don't know what the medical examiner meant. He said, your daughter was textbook final exit.
Was what?
And I almost
Textbook final exit.
Oh, textbook final exit. Oh,
she said, what is that? I said, oh, my God. He published this book that gave how to self-commit suicide. She used one of the techniques in there. It was not dignified. It was not peaceful and horrible. So I have written and gone all over the United States finding assisted suicide laws.
So this book, there's a book. You're saying there's a book that people can follow to commit suicide.
Oh yeah, websites on it too. And Compassion and Choices, which used to be named Euthanasia Society of America in the 20s, but they didn't get very far. Finally, they started gaining traction, especially with the Brittany Maynard case from several years ago. They tried to get assisted suicide laws passed in the United States. That's why I've been all over. I went out to Colorado.
Right, they were getting them around the country, yeah.
We have 9 states and the District of Columbia now.
Yeah.
And Compassion and Choices is the Planned Parenthood of the death movement. I have debated them many times. And we've done everything we could. I was called to Maryland a couple of years ago. I wrote about it. And they said, it's going to go through. It's a Hail Mary pass, please, you know. And I said, well, I'm not your Hail Mary, but I'll come up. We did. I said, give me the talks. They said, will you do radio? I said, anything you want. We did it. They finally got me in to see one legislator because Compassion and Choices had taken all the testimony times. And I went to one legislator, I talked to him, and I have it in my blog. And they thought he was on the, you know, pro-death. And I talked to him about how it would mean to him personally. When it happened, I even was with a legislator. He says, Nancy, it's going to pass. And I said, have faith. It lost. It didn't pass by one vote.
Wow.
I did 10 talks. I don't even know where I talked or how. They just moved me around. But the final thing, I have one story, and this is why it's so important for people to speak out. I was almost fired from nursing. Nursing has been my life. I love it. But several years ago, I was working in an ICU, and they had a gentleman in there who had a 72 years old, my age, who had a knee replacement. And he did fine. They put him on the cart, and all of a sudden, he had a cardiac arrest. So they brought him into us. We resuscitated him. He was stable. He did great. But he was still on the ventilator, and we had him sedated so he wouldn't fight the ventilator. So they took him off the sedation, and he didn't wake up. And I said, well, give him some time. His kidneys aren't that good. They called in a neurologist who declared him brain dead. I said, he's not brain dead. When I have to remove the ventilator, he breathes off the ventilator. They said, Nancy, yeah, he's not going to go anywhere. I said, no. So I came in one night. The other nurse had not come in. And they said, okay, you've got that guy. He's off the ventilator. We sent the family home. He had a morphine drip running at 30 milligrams an hour, which they told me was a normal oncology dose. I said, listen, I worked oncology. There's no such thing.
Was it too much? Is that what you're saying?
Oh, way too much. That's a whole nother story.
Okay, so they had him overdosed.
The nurse who did it, she said, I said, what? He's on a morphine dose? She said, well, the doctor told me, keep increasing the dose until he stops breathing. He wouldn't stop breathing. Gosh. They sent the family home. I said, excuse me. And she said, well, I couldn't write that. Increase morphine until he stops breathing. She said, I wrote down morphine for comfort, comfort, no limit. That is sometimes put in some nursing homes as a standing order for terminally ill people. That should never be done.
And that's so legal?
I said, I'm turning it off. That's wrong. He's not even uncomfortable. So I went up the chain of command. I talked to the doctor who did the surgeon who did the surgery. He's a good guy, real good guy. He says, I don't want to get involved. I referred to him as Pontius Pilate later on. And I went up the chain of command, and it was night. I was working a night shift. Supervisors, everybody I could get a hold of. And I turned the man's morphine off and kept trying to wake him up. His vital signs were fine. They turned off the monitors, but his vital signs were perfect. Urine output, he was not terminally ill. So anyway, I came back 2 days later and he was gone. Apparently they turned it back on. And I was called into the supervisor's office. She said, Nancy, the doctor wants you fired. And they go, you're a good nurse. We really don't want to fire you. You know, how about if we put a reprimand in? I said, I did nothing wrong. Right. They go, well, okay, how about if we say we educated you on end-of-life issues? I said, I lecture on end-of-life issues, and I've been on ethics committees. This is wrong. So they said, well, go away. We'll try to figure out something. And the whole time I'm thinking, I'm the sole support of my children. What am I doing? Can I sell shoes at a store? I didn't know. But you had to do it. I was a little scared. Anyway, I went home. He was still doing fine. I came back 2 days later. He's gone. He had died. And the story got all over. I didn't tell it, but it got all over the hospital. Some nurses thought I did the right thing. Some didn't. Some people, you know, there was a whole batch of people.
So, Nancy, just to clarify, did you do that without permission? You said you went up the chain of command, but you never got
that was interesting. I told him, I'm also now an advanced legal nurse consultant. I knew the law. I'd help lawyers with some of the laws that we've had. I said, I followed the order. I did nothing wrong. It said, morphine for comfort, no limit. He wasn't uncomfortable. Okay. I followed the letter of the law. I knew I was right. I knew I had it. Uh-huh. It helps to know the law. Yeah. And so anyway, got around, and some people thought I was being good and some didn't. But the interesting thing, a month later, some nurses from another unit came, and I knew the patient they were talking about. And they said he had lung problems. And they talked to him about, you know, do you want to go? And he said, well, talk to my family. You know, it was just a nutty situation. The doctor came in and ordered a huge dose of morphine for him. And the nurses down there said, we remember what happened to you. Every single one of them went to the doctor and said, hell no, we won't give it. You give it. He goes, I'm not going to give it. It took several years, but eventually they stopped doing that.
That's wonderful.
The power of one. I didn't get fired, and actually some good came out of it. So I tell people, have faith, step out, do it. It's worth it. Even if I wind up in the Google.
Does the National Association of Pro-Life Nurses, is there a standing committee on ethical issues, or how do they make their decisions on their positions?
It's not hard. With the ethics, and I've written about this before, the history of ethics, because I wanted to find out how did Roe versus Wade happen when it had always been illegal. I didn't know. I went back and started looking. In the 70s, ethics started changing. It became bioethics. And some, including some good Catholic ethicists, were getting on board. And what it was, instead of we do not harm anybody or any of that stuff, you know, we don't kill or anything else, they came up with basically four new principles. Autonomy, which means choice. They had, you say you're not going to do any, you know, whatever it is not harmful. We will never do anything malevolent. And they always have some way of trying to get around that. Mm-hmm. And the fourth one was really interesting. Social justice.
Oh, boy.
Oh, that word. Yes.
This was in the mid-70s. Yeah, that's why I wanted to get to that. That actually happened. I've written quite a bit on this. Mm-hmm. The new ethics, the new bioethics has really taken over. Mm-hmm. It has happened everywhere. So you see so many of these prominent doctors and the ethicists like Arthur Kaplan. He goes, well, I'm really not for it, but no, I can see if it's somebody's choice. And in 1997, it went to the U.S. Supreme Court, Bacco versus Quiller, Quill versus Bacco. And I wrote the brief for the National Association of Pro-Life Nurses. Mm. And we really gave it to them on what it is. And we actually got a note back afterwards from one of the people who was fighting it. And he said, your brief made a difference. You know, I said, I can die now happy. We wound up, the Supreme Court ruled 9-0 against a fundamental right to assisted suicide. But what's going on now, and I just wrote a blog about the population decline and the birth dearth and how abortion and euthanasia fit in. Mm-hmm. I wrote in there, I said, the way it's going now, and they've got so much money, compassionate choices, we may face another case like that where they're trying to make it a fundamental right.
Oh, brother.
The terminally ill, just like they did with Roe versus Wade, when they go, it's only for the first 3 months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that was the last blog I wrote, and that's been republished in the National Right to Life News. Uh-huh. I give permission to anybody to use any of my stuff. If you like it, go ahead and use it.
That's wonderful.
I have not copyrighted anything.
That's
just wonderful. Don't change the words.
Yeah. What are your thoughts of Margaret Sanger? And I'm sure you're aware she's in the American Nurses Association Hall of Fame, which has always been
a
thorn in my side. What do you think?
Well, interestingly, last year, the Margaret Sanger Planned Parenthood Clinic in New York, the flagship of Planned Parenthood, took her name off.
Yes.
It's no longer the Planned Parenthood Clinic. And they go, yeah, well, she had some problems. Well, I'll tell you what kind of problems she has. 2 years ago, I was asked to review for a medical journal a new book called Nurses and Midwives in Nazi Germany. And they wanted me to review it. And I went, oh, because I didn't know. And if you go on the American Nurses Association website, you can't find anything about this. It turns out this was from the eugenics movement with Margaret Sanger. Uh-huh. The American Nurses Association even had something. Oh, that was a good idea, this eugenicist type thing. That is what was behind all the stuff in Nazi Germany. I mean, it's a wonderful book. It's not very long. I highly recommend it to everybody. But the interesting thing is, and my book review has been published constantly. The beautiful part of it, the reason I wanted to write the review, is these two nurses, what they did, they go, this is so horrific. How could these nurses do it? You know, all this other stuff. What they did, they said, we need to teach nursing differently. And what they did is they had some classes and they kind of went backwards. Instead of teaching ethics as we don't starve Down syndrome kids or whatever, they started with Nazi Germany as the worst case scenario. And without pushing anything, they talked to the students and they said, a lot of the students then said, you know, I think I'm against abortion too. Fascinating book. So I'm very glad I wrote that, and it's still being picked up all over. Wonderful book. But that was what they did. And I said, maybe that's what we need to do. And I've written about it. We need to teach, instead of this thing of, is abortion bad or good or whatever? Let's teach from Nazi Germany, when the midwives went out and they were told and had to report any other child in the family who looked a little bit dull or whatever. So they could come in and say, oh, we're going to send your child to a special school and everything. They'd kill them and then tell the families, your son or daughter died. Horrific stuff.
I would like to read that book. That sounds very interesting.
Especially as a nurse. I mean, I was just horrified. It was hard to read.
Yeah.
Well, I have
Nancy,
some good news.
We're going to have to cut this, bring this to an end, I guess. You're so fascinating. We have a couple announcements we want to make, but we want to thank you so much for being on the program, and we encourage all of you to go to her blog, nancyvalko.com, right? Your blog?
Yeah, V-A-L-K-O.
V-A-L-K-O.
And people can contact me through there,
and
too.
If you go on there, she has the issues listed. Very easy to follow, her contact information, and also the contact information for the National Association of Pro-Life Nurses. So there's a wealth of information out there for viewers. If you have any questions or, you know, maybe you need some
help. Tell student nurses, you know, we're here to take
care
of
and there's
everybody.
Plenty of nurses around here that need to get their feet firmly on the ground on some of these issues.
So they can take a stand. I gave a talk one time and some nurse started crying in the middle of it. I didn't know she was a nurse. I went up, I said, did I say something that bothered you? She said, no, I cried because I'm ashamed. I went along with some of this without really thinking about it.
I have some good news for you. On Friday, June the 21st, the Supreme Court had another ruling of 9-0. Okay. What they did is they passed the... they delivered a unanimous judgment in favor of religious freedom, something that we've been fighting for a long time, that they all sided with the Catholic Social Services, that they can discriminate against same-sex marriages when it comes to adoption. We have a lot of children now that people have decided that they don't want to kill their babies, but they will put them up for adoption. And the city of Philadelphia tried to prevent the Catholic Charities of putting these children, any child, they didn't care. They put all children at risk because they were not going to refer to the Catholic Charities services because they would not vet the LGBT. So now that is not a problem. And then they were putting all children at harm's way.
And that was a unanimous decision, too.
Yes.
But thanks, Nancy. We're going to end there for you. So thanks again.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, dear.
Okay. We have one or two announcements that we want to make also. We mentioned this last month, but we have the National Pro-Life Bridges Day coming up in July, July 16th, 4 to 6 p.m. We're on the overpass on... Berkshire Boulevard near Kissinger Church. It's the overpass for 422.
It's right down from the movie theater.
Down from the movie theater and Why I'm Missing. So very easy to get to. It's safe. There's, you know, barbed wire high on both sides. This is part of a national event. I think this is the fourth year, and we've been involved in it since it started. And we have large banners, pro-life banners we put up. And it's fun, and it's...
We're there for what, four?
For 2 hours.
4 to 6, and thousands of cars go by. And peeping
it's neat.
And then the other the thumbs up.
Yeah, it's great. So yes. Anybody who wants to come out, and you can bring flags or if you have some posters, but we have big posters for that. And then the other thing is, finally, because of COVID, we are going to have the March for Life in Harrisburg. This has been in the works now for 2 years, and then, of course, with COVID, it got shut down. So that, I think, is September 27th, I think. But we'll be announcing that again.
And that'll be on our website as well.
That'll be on. And that'll be in Harrisburg. We've never had a March for Life in Harrisburg yet, and this is a long time coming. This is something we really should have done, I think, years ago. But, you know, it's being done. So let me see. There was one. Oh, and I think I mentioned about the bills. Those bills we mentioned last month, the Fetal Remains Bill, House Bill 118, and House Bill 1500, which was the Down syndrome bill. They both came out of the House, passed, went to the Senate, and the Down syndrome bill came out of committee in the Senate, which means it's being acted on actively. And then we still have the Heartbeat Bill, which is House Bill 904. That one was also passed in the House, and that needs to go to the Senate too. So, you have any other announcements? I think that's it.
Do you want to tell them what the website is?
Oh, our website? Yes, you can go to our website, www.prolifeberks.org, and feel free to, everything on there is free for people to, you know, use, and what we put our newsletter on there. We want to thank again all those who contributed to the billboards that we have at Planned Parenthood. We have two billboards up across the street from Planned Parenthood where people can go to the website or go to or call to get help if they are, you know, faced with an unexpected pregnancy and that they might be possibly considering abortion. We want them to know that there's so much help available, not only here in Berks County, but in the general area, in case they're coming from other areas. So we thank those people who are helping to keep those billboards going. And also, we encourage you to go down to Planned Parenthood. It's 1920 Kutztown Road. You can stand on the sidewalk, just say a quick prayer. You want to hold a sign, that's fine. But mainly that you're just there to be a witness to the killing that's going on there. There's about 15 babies killed there every week. And, you know, if we had 15 two-year-olds killed someplace, you certainly would have a crowd. So we don't want to ever forget what's going on in there. We want the community to know that, you know, it's happening right here under our noses. This isn't just a national issue. So with that, next month, Carolyn is going to be hosting Representative
Jerry Knowles.
Mm-hmm. So he'll be on. We tried to have him on one other time, and it just didn't work out. Technically, it didn't work out. So we're looking forward to him. And then we have some other things planned for August, but we'll let you know about that. So with that, we thank you for tuning in, and good night.
Good night.
Thank you so much.
Pro Life Berks on BCTV is underwritten by Tom Schaefer RV Superstore.